session, I'm going to try to give a brief overview of what is primary biodiversity data, what are the concepts of precision and accuracy when working with primary biodiversity data, and some of the implications of the different aspects of the use of the variability of the primary biodiversity data and its precision and accuracy. What does it mean to have precise or accurate data in the different aspects of the activities? So let's begin. I'll begin asking you a question. How many of you who already know what the primary biodiversity data record is? Anyone? Okay, so I remember Charles said something on the general introduction of the course, but I will repeat a bit that the primary biodiversity data, or PBD, is the most basic piece of information that we can get directly from the field. When we go to the field to sample, we have some basic pieces of information that are free of further interpretation or any further calculations or modification. That's what we call primary biodiversity data. Another way to say so is that primary biodiversity data, one record, one thing, is the definition of what has been seen or collected, and this is it where. So it has the taxonomic part of what has been seen, and the location of that taxon. There's a third element that's also really important, because it allows for a wide range of possible uses of information. That's the when, the date, the moment, the event, day that in which the taxon has been seen or collected. So there are several types of primary biodiversity data. One of the most common ones, in fact, the one that most relates to this workshop, are the occurrences. Occurrences are records of something, some taxon, in some point of space and time. But even inside the occurrences, there are several different types. So we have, for example, the museum specimens. Museum specimens are primary biodiversity data which have a physical record, which is the specimen itself. The organism that has been sampled is then kept and is preserved over time. So it can be reassessed, it can be rechecked, the information it has can be validated. There is other common type of occurrence, that's the field observation, in which the organism that has been seen is not preserved, it's not collected. We don't end up having the organism. So this has some implications on the reliability of this information, because if any of the parts of the PBD is wrongly taken, we don't have the means to reassess it and to evaluate it. So if it's wrong, we'll pass on that. There are other types of occurrences we're not going to work directly with. So we will focus on the museum specimens and the field observations. That's primary biodiversity data. Now let's see, what does precision mean? What does accuracy mean? How do we relate one to each other? So precision is the closeness of repeated measurements to the same value. If we measure something 10 times, and all of them are really close one to each other, their values are similar, then that set of measurements is quite precise. If it's a single value, then the level of detail is the one that is going to tell us the precision of that measurement. On the other hand, the accuracy can be defined as the closeness of a measurement to the true value. In order to know the accuracy of a measurement, we must also know the true value, the real value that information should take. So this can be referencing this example. When combining accuracy and precision, we can have four different scenarios. The first one here, we have a set of measurements. One of these points is a different measurement. All of them are quite close, one to each other, so that's precise set of measurements. And besides, the whole measurements are really close to the center of the inner circle, which is supposed to represent the true value. So that's a set of records that are both accurate and precise. The second case is that we have all the points spread all over the circle, the outside circle. Each measurement is farther from the other, the values might be different, so that's a low precision set of information. But overall, the whole set of records is somewhat close to the center, or at least it relates something to the center of the inner circle. So we can say that's an accurate set of measurements. The third and fourth scenarios are different cases. The third one, we have precise measurements with all the points up together, but they are far from the inner, from the center of the inner circle. So that's a high precision but low accuracy set of measurements. And the fourth one has a different problem. It's not accurate nor precise. It's not accurate because points are far from the center, and it's not precise because the points are not close to each other. Okay? So, precision and accuracy here. Any questions so far? So, as I said, the accuracy depends on knowing the true value of the thing we are looking for. If we don't know, we are unable to know which one is the true value we are searching. We cannot know reliably if our measurements are right and accurate or not. On the other hand, precision is an intrinsic value. We don't need to know anything else but have our records, or our points, or our coordinates or dates in order to know if that's a high, precise or not measurement. So now that we have seen a brief introduction of what primary biodiversity data are, and what's precision and what's accuracy, let's begin to look at the specific implications of the precision and the accuracy on the different aspects of the primary biodiversity data. Let's begin with the where, with the geospatial information. So the best representation, and in fact, the type of representation the standard asks for geospatial data are coordinates. And even more coordinates in a specific system, the decimal degree system. So we can say that the precision in geospatial data is the same as the level of precision in the coordinates. We have here a couple of air coordinates. The left one has only one decimal figure. Is that a precise or imprecise set of coordinates? What do you think? Is that high or low precision, the one on the left? But this is higher, does it have higher or lower precision than the one on the right with four decimal figures? The left one is less precise than the right one. Why? The left one has only one decimal figure. It means that the true value, for example here, minus 1.2, that latitude or longitude, we don't know, has the value might go from 1.15 to 1.25, so that's 0.1 degree of value between both. But in the second one, if we have minus 1.2219, there are several numbers in the decimal places. So the level of variation is much lower in this case. This is a more precise set of coordinates because it defines better, with more precision, the exact location, ideal location, of the things we are measuring. Still, and although the coordinates are the best way of representing geospatial data, the real-world information that's right there, it's geospatial information that is in several different formats. These are some of the examples. There might be above coordinates with high precision, above coordinates with low precision, textual rating, location description. If we have high precision data, then we're going to define that. What happens, for example, in these cases? What if the only geospatial information we have is that organism that's been found in land or in my backyard? Now go and find that backyard. So if this is the original data, if this is the primary information, there's no more original data, it's data taken in the field. There's still a thing to do to improve this. A low precision in the original data, either in geospatial, temporal, taxonomic, whatever, is almost impossible, completely impossible most of the times, to solve a posteriori. So that's the thing we can do to improve that. Still, sometimes it's better not to give a precise location of an organism. Say we're working with sensitive data, with endangered species, with commercially interesting species. We want to publicly make available the precise location of an endangered species so that anyone can go and see what it is. So sensitive data should not be directly available in high resolution format. In fact, there are several works that deal with the sensitive data. There's a best practices guide written by Chapman who specifically deals with these issues and how to generalize, how to mask the precision of the data so that it can be useful, but not too useful. So the good practice in this case is to provide low precision information publicly, but still keep the original high precision data for some specific or particular resource purposes. And the level of imprecision on these coordinates depends on the level of threat, because species is considered extremely delicate, extremely threatening. They might be, the best of them might be not to give coordinates at all, just a vague description of where they can be found. So that's what we need to know about the geospatial precision. Now let's see the geospatial accuracy. While a low precision of information means that that information is going to be less usable, it narrows the possible uses for that information, a low accuracy can actually lead to wrong conclusions if this information is not handled carefully.